Tonight's tinkering is accompanied by Stir Stick Stout from Half Pints Brewing in Winnipeg. They call it a medium-bodied coffee stout with notes of coffee and semi-sweet chocolate. And a little bit of hops because, you know, beer. So for the last evening or two, I've been tinkering around with variations on this little circuit, which is a constant current LED driver. So anybody who's played with LEDs for any length of time knows that there is a maximum current that any given LED will tolerate before it explodes. And in a lot of cases, if you have a constant voltage happening, you can do some math, figure out what an appropriate series resistor is to stay at or below that that current, and then put that in series with the LED so that you have your current is what you expect it to be and is within the toleration of the LED. In this case, 20 milliamps. Got about 5 volts, 5.25 volts coming in, and that's 150 ohm resistor, plus or minus its tolerance. And most normal LEDs, like the 5mm like this, or the 3mm ones, are happy at or below 20 milliamps. But if the voltage varies, let's drop that voltage down here some. Oops, let's go the other down. So we've dropped down to 3 volts. Notice that that is dimmed a little bit. And we've only got 7 milliamps going through, or being drawn. And now if we go up too high, there's 8 volts. We're at 30 milliamps. Let's just see how much this thing will tolerate before it fails. And I'm actually surprised that it's handling like 75 milliamps. That LED is not going to have a long life if I keep running it that hot. But you notice that the important point here is as the voltage changes, the current changes, because Ohm's law says that, oh man, that resistor was getting awfully hot with that kind of current going through it. Anyway, so you can do some Ohm's law math to tell you, you know, what resistor you want to keep your LED happy. That's kind of old hat for most of us that have been playing with LEDs for any length of time. But if your voltage is changing, then you can't use that method unless you, you know, estimate really low. But still, it's not always the most effective method. And that's why I've been playing with this little constant current circuit. It's not really an LED driver. I mean, constant current is really good for LED drivers, but it could be anything. You could power anything with it that needs a constant current power supply. For instance, charging batteries that want constant current, although there is some caveats there. I mean, I wouldn't want to use this alone for a battery charger, but it would be reasonable. So there we go. No changes over here. The LED is pretty much as bright, drawing again about 23 milliamps because the transistors and resistor are drawing a bit more voltage, or a bit more current. But watch what happens when I crank the voltage up to ridiculous levels here. There's 10 volts, 11 volts. Essentially hasn't changed. Let's just put an ammeter in series with the LED here. So we've still got 10.9 volts there. Let's just drop back down to about 5 volts. Let's drop a couple of tenths of a milliamp, negligible amount. Let's crank it back up to stupid levels here. There's 15.5 volts. Still, the LED's still nice and happy at 20-ish milliamps. And none of these resistors are getting hot. That one transistor is getting a little bit warm, but not so much that it would be problematic. So what is this circuit? Well, it's, as you can see, it's got 2 transistors and 2 resistors in it. So let's just quickly draw it out. Got voltage coming in here, positive voltage. Goes through the LED to the collector of one of the transistors, NPN transistors. I'm using 2N2222 transistors, the most generic and memorable part number that you can come up with. Anyway, so the emitter of this poorly drawn transistor goes down and goes to the base of the second transistor, and also through a current sense resistor to ground. The emitter of the second transistor also goes to ground. The collector of that one goes up to the base of this guy and then out to another resistor, which in this case is 1K, and that is the control line. So with that, you can turn this whole thing on and off with like a negligible amount of current. Basically, the collector, the 1K in series with this transistor when it's conducting. So how this guy works, this little current sense transistor here is the control of it. Basically, that current sense transistor with the current of the LED flowing through that through there wants to have about 0.7 volts on it, which is the turn on voltage for this transistor, 0.6, 0.7 in that range. So you do a little bit of math to figure, or based on the desired current up here. And that is 0.7 volts, which is what you want to turn this transistor on, over your desired current, which is straight out of Ohm's law. Easy peasy. So in this case over here, because I wanted 20 milliamps, 0.7 volts over 0.02 gives me about a 35 ohm resistor. 35 ohms isn't the standard value, so I think that is a 37, I think. Regardless, that gets us close enough, right? Usually you'll round up high just for safety, so you're not overdriving this guy. So if we wanted this guy to drive a higher power LED, like say maybe one of these 5-watt units, all we would have to do is change out the resistor. So in this case, I've got a 3.5 ohm resistor that I'm going to put in there, which will allow us, what is that going to be, 100 milliamps? Something like that, I think. We'll just put that in here and see what happens. 146 milliamps, okay. So what is, I must have grabbed the wrong resistor. Regardless, so you can see that that's still happening. And again, nothing over here is getting hot. So one of the reasons it's not getting hot, this LED uses its forward voltage drop is about 8.8 volts. So we've got, what do we got here? 12 volts over there. So what is that? 3-ish volts being dropped across that transistor and the load resistor there, or the sensing resistor. So there's not, even though there's a fair bit of current going through there, it's not getting stupidly hot. I mean, it's getting a little bit warm, but it's not ridiculously hot. So that's one part of this circuit. The other part is, remember that control line over here? That is this wire up here. Super low current. So we can control the thing with that. And if we can turn it on and off, that probably also means we can PWM dim it. So I'll just plug my little PWM module in there. Let's bring this guy down. I think you can see it's starting to dim there. 20% duty cycle, 10, 9. Yeah. So you can sort of see it dimming itself out. So that means that we can use anything that can generate a PWM signal to control pretty much any LED, as long as we have big enough transistors and the right resistors chosen. And because these are just basic NPN transistors, I could easily swap that one out. That one is this one here, for one that can handle, you know, multiple amps and take a big heat sink and whatnot, and drive pretty much any huge LED that I wanted. Here's another example. Not sure whether you can see that or not. Let me just shine that down onto something. Okay, this flicker is going to be annoying, and I apologize for that, but I'll just do this as quickly as possible. So what I've got the Arduino set up to do is basically take these three potentiometers as analog inputs, just a voltage, and I've got three PWMs going out to this RGB LED here. So let's turn down the blue. I think you can see that happening. Do I have these wrong? I do. So ignore the wire colors. So there's basically all of them off. There's bringing in some blue and back out again. Not sure which one this is there. It must be, that's green, I guess. And that means this one must be red by elimination. Let's make a purple. Something like that. Okay, but you can see how basically that same circuit, just duplicated three times, can be used with anything to PWM control an LED. And I think that is pretty cool. And again, I've just, you've got the same power supply on here, and all three channels are fairly dim at the moment. I'm only drawing 50 milliamps. I'm just going to quickly crank it up here. And yeah, so the whole thing is drawing 175-ish milliamps divided by those three. And I don't want to run that hot too long because I don't have a heat sink on it. A little bit disappointed about the PWM flicker, but I'm pretty sure I can have an application for that. Obviously, I can compact that down a whole bunch. But yeah, do you recall me getting that DMX light and coming up just quickly with an Arduino-based DMX controller? Well, I think I could probably, actually I'm planning on eventually, doing an Arduino DMX receiver and seeing how small I can get that, and using it with either an RGB LED like that one, or individual 5-watt red, green, and blue LEDs in that same form factor. Perhaps with a lens. I don't know, we'll see. It seems to me like an interesting experiment. Something else I thought about while I was working with these things. Remember our old friend, the WS2812, aka NeoPixel? And you may also remember that I have some of the, basically, the chip that's inside those that does the controlling is a WS2811. These ones. So what that guy allows you to do is control arbitrary LEDs the same as you would a NeoPixel string. I've actually got those cascaded. This little controller here is running into the 2811. And the 2811 is then cascaded out into this string here. So then with all of this connected together, the WS2811 feeding into the control inputs of these three transistor circuits, and I am just using pots to set the level, just because there is a difference in voltage between these two circuits. So those pots are adjusted, and I think you can see that this guy is pulsing along. There, does that make it any easier to see the colors changing? I'm not sure. Anyway, I think that is pretty neat, that you can basically create a NeoPixel at any power level all of a sudden. Again, just by picking the appropriate transistors so you're not drawing way too much current through them. I guess I should probably give credit to Kevin Dara, who is the YouTuber who first showed me this little circuit here. this little circuit here. And I'll link to his YouTube video down below. He goes deeper into the theory than I did, and has a simulation and whatnot just to demonstrate it. This isn't the only way you can do a constant current circuit. If you Google for constant current circuit, there's dozens and dozens of them, using all manner of different components. But this, with two transistors and two resistors, is the simplest one that I have found so far. And I think I'm going to use it for some future experiments and maybe a project or two eventually. But in the meantime, I think I'm going to leave it here, and I'm going to go upstairs and finish my beer. Thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below, as usual. I'll talk to you later.